Bet y'all weren't expecting this. I wasn't either, to tell you the truth, but this is going to be part reaction video plus part channel update. The thing is, when you're making a YouTube reaction video, I don't want to say like a lot of effort goes into it. You're mostly watching a screen and you're compositing what you're watching on the screen with you, but there's a lot of editing that goes into that. And when you're working a job, well, you don't have a lot of free time on your hands, so it can be kind of exhausting. And the process is long enough. For me, it takes like a day and a half for a reaction video to be made. And this process gets even more complicated with YouTube's policies of fair use, which I find just laughable. The reason why I find them laughable is because a lot of people say, well, you can only use 10 minutes of footage. But I thought as long as it was being used for educational purposes, as long as you're not just showing the original format and you're talking over it. Like, if I want to watch a bootleg version of Game of Thrones, I'm not going to look at some Yahoo watching it. I'm going to try to download it illegally and watch it. I'm not going to go to YouTube. That's the first reason I find it laughable. Second reason I find it laughable is that there are bigger YouTube channels than me, and hence the emphasis on the word bigger, like thousands of followers. Clearly violate the YouTube copyright laws. I'm not going to name names because they're really not doing anything wrong. It's more or less talking about just how inconsistent this policy is. These large channels will have 15 to 20, I've seen some that have 30 minutes of footage. It's heavily edited, but there's still 30 minutes of footage. And they have their videos on YouTube. So it's clearly something that's reserved for the greenhorns, like myself. And I don't know, maybe that's how I have to earn my pounds of flesh. Maybe when I get 200,000 followers, if that even happens, and I get the ad revenue, maybe YouTube will turn a blind eye. Because the only thing that YouTube likes more than ridiculous rules is making money. As far as me reacting to Game of Thrones, I still haven't watched any episodes because part of me is still wanting to do genuine reactions, me watching it for the first time. And the last episode I saw was really good because it, what's his name? Jamie Stark fought the large woman. I forgot her name. She kind of reminds me of like a grown-up version of Arya. She has like really silvery blonde hair, really big. In fact, she's mocked a lot for that because she almost looks like a man. She's a really cool character. Last episode, they had a fight to a draw, and Jamie Lannister, I'm assuming, is going to get abducted by another party because they got ratted out on by that guy that they spared. I never even put up that episode. It's still sitting on my drive. I want to put it up there. I may try again this winter. No promises. I may try again. But like I said, a lot of time and effort goes into it. And when you have to constantly re-edit it, and those re-edits aren't enough, it doesn't make the whole experience really that fun or something you want to look forward to, which is why when you look at some of my later episodes, I look really fatigued and tired, and the reactions are kind of dull. It's because it's not something I was looking forward to, and I don't like feeling that way because that's an awesome show, and I can see why people liked it so much, except for the last season. I don't know why, but everybody hates it for some reason. I suppose I'm going to find out eventually. But enough of that. That's my channel update. Now we're on to Ghostbusters Afterlife, which is a sequel. Unlike the 2016 film, which was a reboot, this is a sequel. It's taking place, I'm assuming, after the events of the second one. And it'd be nice if they threw in like a nod to the 2007 video game, but I don't know. Because I remember Harold Ramis and Dan Aykroyd said that the PS3 game that came out in 2007, that they said that was the third Ghostbusters. And it had all the cast in there, except for Sigourney Weaver. And the guy who played Lewis Tully, Harold Ramis. But other than them, had all the original casts. A little background with me, I'm not really a big Ghostbusters fan, and this is probably going to throw a lot of y'all for a loop. I saw the second one before I saw the first one, and I like the second one more. A lot of people don't like the second one. I find it just about as good as the first one. Again, I don't really love them. Really, my Ghostbusters is Men in Black. Men in Black is the Ghostbusters for the 90s. I mean, if you want further proof, both movies have a namesake pop song that blew up the Billboard charts. And it's very iconic. Both respective pop songs are iconic in their own regard. But yeah, I've seen the first one. It's good for what it is. A bit dated in some areas, but I can see why people liked it, because it was a special effects film that wasn't action adventure. It was comedy. It was one of the most expensive comedies ever made. In fact, I think it still may hold that title. Like, I can't really think of any other comedies that would be that big and epic in scope. But yeah, say what you will about the Ghostbusters from 2016. Yeah, say what you will. I don't really know. All I know is that the media buzz around the 2016 film made me not want to watch it. To this day, I have not seen it. From what I've heard, it's not good. Even from people who wanted to like it for their own political reasons, they say it's not great. I think it's pretty stupid that Ghostbusters became the ground zero of this culture war that's just inescapable now. But from what I heard, that it wasn't all that great. But they're going to try again. And the guy who was Ivan Reitman's son is directing this one. So that might be, that might make it good or that might make it bad. I heard the original cast is going to come back in this one. Part of me is waiting for them to come in at the end. Because, you know, having them earlier in the film is just nostalgia bait. And this film's very existence is nostalgia bait, but I think holding off on that and getting used to new characters can make nostalgia bait an actual decent film. And what makes the threshold from nostalgia bait to a decent film is how much of it can stand on its own without so many callbacks. To me, the best example of this is Blade Runner 2049. That, to me, is the best example of a film that could be considered nostalgia bait, but it actually became its own thing. And I actually heard some say it's better than the first one. But I've never seen the first one. I've seen Blade Runner 2049, but the fact that I never saw the first one, I was able to enjoy Blade Runner 2049, showed that that film was not nostalgia bait. I may react to Blade Runner. I don't know. Like I said, no promises. I remember a few months ago, I said I was going to react to Scarface, and I still haven't done that. But all right, let's get this show on the road, so to speak. It's Ghostbusters Afterlife. Alrighty.
You're a great mom.
I don't know. I'm fine with Trevor. But with Phoebe, she really keeps me on the outside.
That's normal.
She's an awkward, nerdy kid.
Already getting Stranger Things vibes already.
Maybe you have an opportunity to start fresh. I just wish you'd get into some trouble.
There's still time.
Uh-oh. Ghost trap.
What are you doing here in Somerville anyway?
We're completely broke. And our grandfather left us this creepy old farmhouse in the middle of nowhere.
Your father wasn't much of a homemaker. He can hardly keep the
You're saying he left us nothing?
Well, I wouldn't say nothing.
You went with the station wagon?
It's the only one that had an engine.
Man, that extra one's been through it. Jason, right?
What is happening here? Somehow, a town with no fault lines is shaking on a daily basis.
Maybe it's the apocalypse. We can't get out here for a reason.
Are you troubled by strange noises in the middle of the night?
You experience feelings of dread in your basement or attic?
You or any of your family ever seen a school inspector or ghost?
Oh my God.
You guys hear that?
Something's coming.
The whole city. It's like The Walking Dead.
Oh, it's a terror dog.
Ah.
closed.
Okay. All right. Like I said, nostalgia bait, but dang it, it just works. Because, let's face it, the stuff that's coming out now, you got to retreat to the past sometimes. The terror dog looked nice. Because, like I said, the old one, for what it was, is good, but the effects is dated. When it jumped out of the closet and landed on the table, it looked real bad. I don't think Phil Tippett worked on that one. But, yeah, that looked good. I'm assuming that, what is the villain of the first film? Not Zool. That's the terror dog. Zool and Vince Clitheroe is the name of the other terror dog. They work for... Oh, God. This is like Jeopardy. Oh, aim for the flat top. What's her name? Or its name. It wasn't really a she. It could take any form. Yeah, well, my brain's kind of drawing blanks right now. I want to say Viggo the Carpathian, but that was the villain in the second one. And that villain isn't as iconic as the one from the first one. What was its name? Alright. I felt Jeopardy. Let me know what your thoughts of Ghostbusters Afterlife are. What are you excited? Do you not care? If you are excited, what are you skeptical of? If you don't care, what would make you care? Why did people like Stay Puft so much? Answer me that question. Alright, thank you. Like, comment, and subscribe, and we'll see what happens with this channel around winter. Ah, winter is coming. See that? See what I did there? It's a Game of Thrones thing.